Hello and welcome to the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, episode 241, Ask Deanna Anything. Get to know our new host. A big thanks to Grand Gamers Guild for sponsoring this episode.
We start off tonight with a Get to Know You segment, letting our fans ask our latest addition to the live show, Deanna, anything they want. After that, we've got a ton of recent plays to share, including Telestrations, Matches, Point Salad, Icecool, Boop, Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay, Elector Accounts, Dragon's Dice, Targi, A Return to KAPOW, Wreck Raiders, First Thoughts on Fantastic Factories, First Thoughts on Hamburg, and a real true classic from 1986 Deanna and I discovered called Round 4. We wrap up with three reviews, Fantastic Factories, Dubious, and Pirate Tails.
Well, before we get into all that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me, we have Deanna.
Hey there, fellow cardboard connoisseurs.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
Show up Wednesday nights live at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com, episode 241. That's 241. Links there may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing at all to use.
Now, one final heads up. Some of the games we mentioned tonight were provided by publishers in the form of review copies.
The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
For the better part of the last 5 years, that has meant Sean and I here letting you know of our thoughts on games or sharing gaming advice. The whole time, though, Deanna has been with us, but in the background, running the website, editing my work, helping us with SEO and more.
Well, she has joined us on the show a few times over the years. We decided this year to have her on more often. It's been working out well, and the fan response has been very positive, so we decided to make her a permanent part of the podcast.
Now, since Sean and I have been at this for quite some time, and everyone has had plenty of time to get to know both of us, both just through listening to our episodes as well as through our AMA-style episodes, we thought it'd be worth doing something to give you all a chance to get to know Deanna a bit better. Now, while I've noted her preferences for heavier games and her dislike of co-ops and dexterity games many times, but this is a chance to actually hear it from the source and ask any questions you have of our newest edition.
Well, Dee, before we get to any of the grilling, is there anything you want to say?
This is not coffee.
That is not coffee at all. Okay.
That is not coffee. I'm having a beer. Good evening, folks.
So I gave our fans a bit of a heads up on this week's topic, and we had a couple of people in the Tabletop Bellhop Discord, which you can find at discord.tabletopbellhop.com, sending questions because they couldn't make it here tonight. So we're going to start off with two of those and then give the lobby some time to get some questions in. I already have some flowing in, so that's awesome. We'll get to these two questions from our Discord first, and then we will open it up to the floor.
All right, well, the first question comes from Paxenarian, who asks, what's a game about which you had really strong opinions that didn't get fully aired on the podcast because you were staying behind the scenes? While Mo usually gives your point of view, maybe there's a time when you would have elaborated, said it differently, or been more adamant.
Mo is so diplomatic when it comes to talking about games that sometimes we don't like, and I am just a little more harsh on that. And often I'll be like, this game is just dreadful, and Mo can look at it and say, no, I know who it's for. It's for this type of gamer, or this person would like it, or these are the good parts about it. And I'm working on being more analytical, because I will often sit down and I'll just go, I didn't like that. Why? I don't know. It sucked, and I never want to play it again. And that's not helpful, particularly not in a game reviewer sense. I know that often, if you're in the chat room when the guys were talking about games, I might add in things because I was in the chat room moderating even when I wasn't on the screen. I could not think of a particular example, and I also don't like to trash talk stuff. Like I said, I admire Mo's analytical skills and the fact that he can be diplomatic about it. I was trying to go through and pick some of my favorite games and ones that I didn't like, and I said I can't. I have a hard time breaking down what I do and do not like about a game. Something I'm working on.
It is always tough because I run into some of that same difficulty. I've just had a lot more practice biting my tongue and not giving negative reviews because, you know, there's games we all don't like. But we're not here to say this game stinks. That's not what we do. As much as it might stink to me, Mo's right. There really are people who will enjoy a game. And even if it doesn't work for us, we're here to tell you who might enjoy it.
Yep. We said many, many times, or at least I've said, we both said, I think, not every game is for everyone. And that's awesome.
Yep.
That's what makes the industry what it is. And why is there such a wide variety of games on the market? And there's something out there for everyone.
The key words you listen to for in reviews is, well, Sean's a little bit harsher on that than I am. And things like that. Those are the key words that that generally mean that someone has been biting their tongue.
No, wait, not to say that we totally sugarcoat it either, because we do give negative reviews. I don't want to give the wrong idea here, but Mo's just better at being analytical about it than I am.
So is there one in particular?
I couldn't think of one.
Not that you want to bash a game, but like something I was like, no, this is actually quite good. It's this. And you're like, nah, I didn't see what you saw there.
Oh, you know what? I don't like Night Cage. I don't care for it at all. And I think you might have said that I did at some point in the review, or implied that I did, because someone came up to me, and I can't remember who it was, at the event at the brewery, and was like, oh, so you liked that game, eh? You really dug it, even though it's cooperative? And I was like, no, that's a dirty lie. So there you go.
There we go.
I have to look at the review. We just published it. I can't remember what I said. I might have said my whole family enjoyed it or something like that.
Well, next we have a question from Brian Kurtz, who asks, Deanna, what's an example of a game that really surprised you before playing it? You were pretty sure it was going to feel or mechanically function a certain way, but when you played it, it turned out completely different.
Oh, gosh, that happens all the time. There, I mean, just in the last little bit, there was Dubious when we sat down to play it. I had no clue where that game was going, but while Mo was reading the rule book, he was so puzzled by it. It was fantastic. Pirate Scroll game that Mo broke out the other day that I thought looked like a kid's game and ended up being super strategic. I think I get consistently surprised by... Because we end up reviewing things that I might not have picked up at the store. Like if I went to the game store and I was looking on the shelves and I was picking up games, they are not necessarily the same ones that we end up reviewing. Even though we are really picky about what we take to review, I mean, it's all three of us. And also sometimes we do get surprise items, or items that are pushed on us in a way that we just can't politely say no. And then often those end up turning out to be great. So again, I am failing at thinking of examples. It happens all the time. I'm constantly surprised by games. I go in thinking that that looks terrible. I don't even want to play that. And then it's actually pretty good. And that happens fairly consistently because apparently I'm pessimistic.
Well, I think social deduction is one of those ones where we all kind of have a bit of a negative view about it. Whereas Dubious, while it's social deduction, isn't really. And so that, you know, it went one way and then came another. And then we were told we had to take a specific game home from Origins if we wanted any of the other reviews. And it was a social deduction game that we were not excited to take home, but we ended up loving it. So, you know, there's a bunch of those that sort of pop up here and there.
Yeah, the two I can think of, Psychobabble being the one Sean's just alluding to, but also the Goblin, Kiss the Goblin.
Kiss the Goblin. That game doesn't look like much. I barely got it talked into coming and sitting down at the table to play it. I had no interest in that game. It's actually super fun for a party game, for that style of game. Not the kind of stuff I usually dig.
There we go. All right, well, we're going to move into the lobby now with some live questions. We've got the question here. Oh, things are changing in front of me as I go.
Sorry.
From Eggman.
Just breaking up. One person has sent a lot of questions, which we do appreciate. I'm just trying to break it up.
All right. Well, from Eggman Jr., what is your favorite game of all time, comma, what is your favorite game of the last year?
You know, for the longest time, I would say that was Trajan. That was definitely my favorite game. I really dig a good point salad, but I haven't played it in forever. And we played Marrakesh the other day, and I think it might replace Trajan for me. I don't know. There are so many games I like. I was actually doing the this or that Meeple Pub thing, trying to figure out my top 20, because I floundered at making a list on my own, but that thing is so time intensive. I wasted hours on it and I didn't finish. But it did have me thinking about some older ones that I like that I haven't played in a long time. Like I really dig Attica and Hacienda and Turn and Taxis and Steam and Russian Railroads. Those are all older ones that I haven't hit the table in a long time that I really dig. For games of the last year, we played Hamburg the other day and I am in love with it. Oh, goodness. What else do I really like? I like Marrakesh. I like Tapestry. Tapestry I can play on Board Game Arena all day long.
I think we're going back more than a year for that one.
Yeah, we are. I only just tried Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition this year and I dig it. I like a crunchy point salad.
Well, Trajan was the first, and it would, up until you played Marrakesh, I think Trajan would have remained that game for you. And now you just have to play Trajan again to compare to Marrakesh to see which of those two is going to take the lead overall.
I got to say, here's the question that I would sit down, and this is how I answer this one when people ask me. Out of everything you mentioned, if we're going to start, Sean's going to come over right now and we're going to play a game. What do you want to play?
Oh, I want to show Sean Hamburg because we just there played it the other day and he hasn't.
That's what I go with. That's why I always say my top game of right now is this. Not my top game of all time. Top game of right now is this, because that's what I want to go play right now. Mm-hmm. And we all know that the best game in your collection is the one that hits your table.
All right. Well, moving on to a question from Roger. Do you know what board game you dreaded or didn't want to play ended up giving you a pleasant surprise?
So, which is similar to the last question.
It is, but the one that immediately came to mind for this was the Deadlies. We only took it to be polite. I had no interest in this game. It was described to me as Uno on crack. And I was like, all right, well, let's open it up and play it to get it out of the way because we have an obligation to it. And it was super fun. We loved it from the very first time we played it, have played it with zillions of different groups. And everyone we have shown it to loves it. And it is just a stupid, simple game. And I don't usually love stupid, simple games. And I love that game. And I dreaded it. I didn't want to play it. But I mean, I think Mo sees often, anytime we have to review a party game, a Dex game, social deduction game, that's it. I don't want to play them. And if I end up liking it, it's a nice surprise. And we've had a couple of those surprises recently with co-op games that I've enjoyed. So,
all right. Well, on the same tone, Tech asks, I know you aren't a big fan of dexterity games, but what was it about Catch the Moon that made you play it?
I was forced to play it, but I don't mind that one. No, I was honestly, what made me play it was Mo brought me out to a coffee shop and put it in front of me and said, this is Catch the Moon. And I wasn't going to get up and leave. So, but I like it. I don't mind that one. It's okay for a dex game. I also don't mind Hamster Roll, but I mean, honestly, I could think of 8 million things I would rather play than any dex game on the planet.
We have another question here from Pax. How do you think your perspective on games and gaming differs from Mo's and mine based on your identity and life experiences, being a woman, being a mom, where you grew up, or early experiences?
Well, I mean, I've been a lifelong gamer. I would say I've been a gamer since I was like 7 or 8. I played Dark Tower. I was into Redbox D&D. I think Mo and Sean and I had a lot of the same early experiences, and we also grew up in the same city. But as far as being a woman in gaming, that's actually part of why I had a conversation with Mo about being more visible on the podcast, because I don't think there are a lot of women that are visible in board gaming that are older women. Like, you know, I'm pushing 50. You don't see a lot of older women that are visible in board gaming content creation, in RPGs more so than board gaming, I feel. I loved going to Gamma this year and just seeing how many women were there that were store owners and in retail and in the publishing side of things. I didn't sit down to demo a game at Gamma Expo where I was the only female at the table, so that was cool. Mm-hmm. I'm not even going to get into the fact that, yes, I've had terrible, stupid cliche like experiences as a female gamer over the years, so that's certainly tainted my experiences.
All right. Well, Eggman Jr. asks, what convention would you like to attend that you've never been to, assuming that cost and time wasn't an issue?
Not Gen Con, because the pictures of the crowds make me want to know. Maybe like PAX Unplugged or like one of the Dice Tower ones, something like that. If money and time is not an issue, go on one of those cruise ship ones. There we go. They do a Dice Tower cruise, don't they?
I've always wanted to go to the one in Ottawa. The big Ottawa one always appealed to me. I know you like Ottawa. I don't know if there's one in Quebec.
Well, if there was, I would assume French.
But yeah, Board Game Geek Con's always interested me because, again, that's not a big one. Because D and I are on the same page when it comes to the crowds. That's a no-no. Mo's, I think, the only one of us who actually wants to go to Gen Con.
Got another one from PAX here. What's the mark that you feel you've been able to put on the podcast or the Bellhop universe? What are you most proud of?
I'm proud of the website. I built that thing. It's mine. When we first started out, my friend Aaron helped me get it set up. But since then, she has been consumed by life. And so she's not always on hand to help me out. And I have to figure out how the heck to do it myself. So I am very proud of our website. Just the editing and everything about the website. I like it. I'm pleased with it. If it sucks, maybe write me and tell me. But maybe I don't want to know. And then the other thing recently is I've been taking over on the Instagram account for Tabletop Bellhop, and I've been doing reels every day, but I've only started like not even 2 weeks that I've been doing that. But that's something that I've been having some fun with. So there's that. I got Mo to go to the park and play with board games, and I took video of it. So that was fun.
And I think one thing that probably doesn't get recognition, or at least enough recognition, is your SEO work, even on just little things like the show titles. You basically have had your hand in almost every show title all the way along because you're the one who knows and understands the SEO and the you want to make sure this word's in there and you got to repeat this and that just to give us that little extra boost we hope we might get eventually over time and in the long term content and get us to where our views are. That's D. I mean, Mo comes up with ideas and I toss some stuff out there, but the final determination generally comes down to D and what is best for long-term view counts and things.
Yep. Like I said, I'm proud of the website. I'm proud of the traffic we get to the website, which that's from all the tweaking and SEO stuff. Yep.
So Eggman Jr. asks, besides board games, do you have another hobby you enjoy?
Not recently. It's like there's not enough hours in the day since we started doing this professionally. What else do I like? I like video games, but like JRPG style video games like Dragon Quest and stuff. I like books, but I had vision issues, which meant I'm only now finally starting to be able to read books again with any like for more than 10-15 minutes at a go. So that's nice. I really missed it. Well, what the heck else do I do?
Comic books, graphic novels,
comic books, graphic novels, books. Books, more books. I like books. Books shopping and games.
For used books. I'd say one of your hobbies used to be collecting books.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You don't like we used to go and like always ask to look at the back rooms at the bookstores and behind the glass cases. And
yeah,
you're always looking for first editions of specific books. I'll let you talk about which ones you like.
I have a large-ish collection of like first printing rare, really old stuff. I started collecting really old books when I was like 10. I go to garage sales, and if I could find a book that was from 1900 or older, like I'd buy it, right? Like I was like, yeah. And now all that stuff that was 100 years old then is like 130 years old now. So I have an entire bookshelf that's just all books that are over 100 years old, and I would get anything if it was 100 years old. I have weird books on Canadian history, bad weird romance novels. You have no idea as long as it was 100 years old. And one time I bought one, I brought it home, and it was full of pressed four-leaf clovers in the back. So that amused me. And I found like 100-year-old pressed four-leaf clovers.
All right, well, moving on that same topic, what genre would you say you like best in books?
Sci-fi, fantasy, comparative folk tales and fairy tales, and then classical Greece and ancient Rome nonfiction stuff. All of that. Oh, and young adult.
Not books on marketing and SEO.
No, though I read those, but I don't like them.
All right. Well, Eggman Jr. Asks, you said you're not a big co-op fan, but recently have mentioned a few that you enjoyed. Is there a game type that you don't like and haven't had a game change your mind?
I really do not like social deduction, like the werewolf style of game. I've yet to find something to change my mind on that, really. And dexterity games, flicking games, Like, if I'm playing that, it's only because I want to be polite and there's other people there that want to be playing that.
What about real time?
Real time? Oh, gosh, no. No, that's not happening. No, there's no real time. What is that one that fuse? That's bad. Fuse? There's that space game. Is it, which one is the space alert where you have to go real time? No, that's terrible. We do not do real time.
Although now you say that, but didn't you, and maybe correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't you somewhat enjoy the train passing game?
I did. That one was okay. And it had dex elements and yeah, right. So I have found some dexterity games that are okay. I've yet to find a flicking game I enjoy at all. I yet to find anything that's speed-based that I like. And social deduction, no.
And, nope. And the train game Sean's mentioning is Rail Pass.
Rail Pass, yes, that's it.
Yes.
Which Rail I still Pass. Have never actually played.
You should try it. I was just thinking about that one when I was going through and trying to rank all the games. Maybe that one should
come out next Walker Bill.
Put it on the menu.
Mo, I think this next question is for you to ask.
Well, it comes from Eggman, but it's how did we meet?
Well, we went to the same high school, but we actually met through the local BBS scene, the online bulletin boards that predated the what you think of as the internet. If you all don't know what I'm talking about. And Mo was running a game of Warhammer Fantasy RPG that he was starting to run on the local BBS, and I had started playing in that game. But I mean, I think we were vaguely aware of each other and chatting on the BBSs. I mean, it was a small sort of community. So yeah, we started dating when we were in grade 12, when I was like 18. And so we have been together for forever. I don't even know. I'm bad because I don't know how many years we've been dating. I don't know how many years we've been married.
Only 12 years less than Mo and I have known each other.
Yes, not much.
Which seemed like a long time back then, but now it doesn't seem like a very long time at all. All right, we're getting on to some other things here. What's your favorite food?
Sushi.
There we go.
I answered that one.
Breakfast, lunch, dinner, sushi.
And favorite movie, even though Mo can't spell.
I'm really bad at just picking one of something. Geesh. I don't know. I really liked Labyrinth growing up as a kid. I think, like, who didn't? But don't play that game. It's awful. That doesn't count as a game.
Yeah, that one I don't even think I was all that nice about.
I like the musical Camelot. What else do I like? Something more modern. I'm drawing a blank. I'm really bad at picking exact things. Sorry.
All right. We got any other questions coming up from the lobby here?
So one of the questions to get into a bit more detail, you mentioned you were a lifelong gamer. Someone did ask, did you play games before meeting Mo? Do you want to expand on what you used to play?
Oh, heck yeah. Yes. But to the detriment of my friends who just wanted to go shopping at the mall. So let's see. What did I play? Oh, Stop Thief. That was really good. Electronic Detective, Dark Tower. Those are all ones that I loved when I was a kid. Plus, like, Scrabble and Trivia Pursuit and all that stuff. Like, we played games a lot in my household, and most of it was because I was forcing people to do it. So I have a brother and a sister, and if you have siblings, you probably know that thing where you trade. You're like, I will do this thing for you if only you will sit down and play Dark Tower with me. Yeah. So I'll help you with your laundry, but you got to play this game with me. It happened a lot. And I got into Redbox D&D when I was like in grade 7. I remember I wanted to buy it in grade 5, and I had saved up money to buy it, and my mom would not let me get it because the whole satanic panic thing. It wasn't so much that. She thought I was going to go into the sewers and die or something. She was really opposed to me. She didn't think I could understand the difference between fiction and reality, and she had concerns. So it took me 2 years of begging her before she would allow me to buy the box set, and I could not get anyone to play it with me. None of my friends at the time had any interest in it, and my mom ended up learning the game and becoming the DM so that I could play, and it was like her and my brother. But I mean, we did that on and off for maybe 1 or 2 years. It wasn't a big thing, but it was very cool that she did that. And then I tried an RPG here or there in my teenage years. None of it ever went well. I did not have welcoming experiences at the table until I started dating Mo, and then got heavily into RPGs at that point because I was the university club I started going to, and role playing there. And then my journey is pretty much the same as Mo's because we were together And eventually we couldn't get our role-playing group together anymore and started playing Catan and getting into board games heavily and all of that.
Favorite role-playing game? Favorites? Some of your favorites?
D&D with skills and powers. I still dig that. Warhammer Fantasy. The original Warhammer Fantasy. Not modern pass the stick role-playing. Get off my lawn.
You made Jeff Seuss cry, but he's not in the chat room.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll get you into a PBTA game sometime. Maybe I'll get you into a super a supers game and see if we can't get you to pass the stick. Although honestly, Masks isn't even as granola and crunchy as some of the stuff out there. It's not like microscope. Traditional. Yeah, it's not like microscope or something, or one of the completely improv ones. Eggman asks, have you played the re-implementation of Stop Thief that Restoration Games put out?
Nope. I'd love to. I haven't played the new version of Dark Tower either. I super want it. But yeah, no, I haven't tried it.
Yeah, the buzz has died off on that. You don't see anyone talking about Dark Tower anymore. I wonder if it kind of
flopped. Don't care. I have personal internal buzz.
I mean, that game, to be fair, that game is kind of niche. And especially if you don't have the fond memories of it. I don't know how often it's going to get to the table, even if it's a great game, even if you love it, how often it's going to hit the table. And
there you go. Eggman owns it. So we'll have to plan something. Maybe the next barbershop.
Oh, wow. Okay. Dark Tower for me was, I went over to my aunt and uncles who lived down in Florida and they didn't have kids and it was boring at their house. And then my uncle went into his closet and pulled down this game. And I went, wow, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen in my entire life. And I loved it so much that he told me I could take it home with me. And that's how I got my copy of Dark Tower.
Eggman points out that it is a way different game than the original. The most divergent of any of the Restoration implementations, but in a good way.
Okay, I was going to say it was scary for a minute.
I was relatively aware of that. Like, I have been paying attention to it. It's been on my radar, so I'm super keen to try it.
All right. Well, Roger's asking, are there any books about board games or gaming in general that you really like?
I can't think of anything. Are there any good books about board gaming? Not that I've run into yet.
As I say, for all the research we do and stuff we do know, buying nonfiction books on board gaming isn't really anything we really
know. No, I have yet. I mean, I've looked at some. I know Mo's gotten some books on like the history of D&D and stuff that he's read through and I've picked up and read parts of. So no, the answer is no.
No, the only thing I would say is maybe the Gamma magazine, because that's actually surprisingly good.
Actually, I really enjoy getting that. I was shocked by how even the advertorials that are in there, because like the publishers pay to be in there and have, you know, write-ups on their upcoming games and stuff, but they're usually very well written and interesting and worth reading. So I even like the advertorials.
Yeah, they're very insider info. Like, why did we do this? Why did we do it this way? How did we go that way? Which is perfect for Gamma, right? Which is an organization where everyone's supposed to be helping each other out. So they're written from a perspective of board game insiders reading it. So it's like there was a really good one on the art project and why they went with that art style and why they went with Institute Trait and what they're trying to do and the push for like what the op is doing, trying to get more into the strategy game market and not just be known as the Monopoly company. And those articles were fascinating.
Yeah, I had read through the magazine first, dog-eared it, gave it to Mo and went, no, you have to read this one, this one, this one.
Yeah, it's interesting. When it comes to gaming nonfiction, a lot of what's out there is either the giant encyclopedic tome, which is just fact after fact after fact. And to be frank, a lot of it exists on Board Game Geek. You don't need a book for it. Or very directed, opinionated topics and discussions of topics, generally with some sort of angle to them or something. but there's a lot of that out there. So unfortunately, there isn't a lot of really high quality, what I would call board game journalism out there in the science fiction. It tends to be either dry encyclopedic or biased in one way or another.
Yeah, it's not science fiction. That's the problem, Sean. I bought a graphic novel for the girls last summer that was about how to design a board game for kids, which I thought looked pretty cool, but then they didn't actually design a board game. So maybe the book was a flop. I don't know.
I'm personally curious about, like, Jeff Engelstein has written a few books. So has, I'm blanking out on a different designer. I know Sen's been involved in a couple books with Banana Chan, stuff like that. But yeah, that's not something we've ever really dove into. It's like Deanna says, time in the day, right? Like I'm much more likely going to go on Board Game Geek and read a thread that's interesting me about a topic than to pick up a full physical book to read. I'm going to read a physical book right now. It's going to be Cyberpunk Red because that's what I'm currently reading.
Eggman Jr. asks, possibly referring to someone in the chat room else, have you played a prototype by a local designer that you really liked?
There was this spider game that I played one time that was made by this guy called Roger. It was pretty cool. It was still a prototype. He was still tweaking it, and I haven't gone back and played it again.
Yeah, we need to play more. I hear there's one coming that features monkeys.
The rumors have been flying.
Because this goes back to your Pax's question about being a mom. What have you done to pass on your love of the board game hobby to our kids?
I was just thinking about this the other day about how exciting it is that they are now old enough to play the games that I like. And I don't mean that in a bad way, because we really cherry picked what kids games we've played over the years. And like, they've played a lot of hobby games over the years, but I'm like, they're now old enough that I can be like, guys, you got to come and play them all. Come downstairs. I have 72 games I want to introduce you to. I like that. I don't know. Must have done something right. They both like games. And I love that Gwen is running the board game club at her school. I just get tickled pink by that. And I love when she comes and talks to me afterwards. And she's like, well, this is the type of people that we're getting. And this is what they're interested in. And the breakdown of trying to figure out what she's going to bring next week and how to teach games and stuff. It's super fun talking that over with her. And I think I've said this on the podcast before. I don't know. I know I've said it to Mo and Sean. I just love that my kids think, because both of our children are girls. We have two daughters, right? Which we talk about all the time. I love that my kids think gaming is for girls. Why wouldn't it be? They have there's zero barrier for entry in their opinion. So I like that.
Yeah, actually the board game club my daughter runs is all but one are women.
Yeah, said awesome. Most weeks, there's more girls than guys there. So that's kind of cool.
So we have a first time chatter asking question tonight. Thank you very much, Cult Cardboard. Asking D, what's your hidden gem game that most people overlooked when it came out?
Oh, I have been really failing at naming particular games tonight. Let me see if I can think of something. Give me a moment. I have a slow thinking brain. Zensu. I love Zensu. People are not talking about Zensu, and I do not understand why. It was originally put out by, I think it's Cheatball Games, which is a UK company, and it was localized here by Outset Media in North America. No one's talking about that game. I do not get it, because I think it's phenomenal.
The fact that you win almost every game probably helps that to some degree.
No, I just, thanks. We'll talk about Targi later in the show. I never win that game. I still like it. So that's not the deciding factor.
We did have a compliment from Tech that I think is worth calling out for those listening at home. I love when she comes out to the events and teaches games. So people appreciate her teaching, which I have to call out because she hates teaching.
She does it, and she does it well. And I'm so proud of her, because I could not have done that when I was 16. I actually had written some of this in the show notes earlier, which is why I didn't the show notes for later in the show, which is why I didn't say it. But like, she comes out to these events and teaches total strangers who are adults how to play games. When I was in high school, I could not have done that. I would have been like, excuse me, I need to go eat my shoes. I'm not capable of even speaking English.
Well, so I think it helps because of the welcoming and open gaming environment you guys have helped create at your home. She hasn't run into the sort of negative experiences that you did early on, both at the role-playing club and at gaming at cons, even somewhat recently at cons, mm-hmm. Where, you know, people just chose not to take you seriously when we all know perfectly well you'd wipe the floor with them if you actually played them in a decent game. And she hasn't had that experience, so she isn't necessarily as anxious about the potential for that happening if she sits down and shows what she knows to adults.
Yeah, but it's cool. Mm-hmm. And it's part of what I love about the local gaming community too, and those public play events. Mm-hmm. It's great.
All right, based on everything that's said, is there anything you want to add, Deanna, that didn't come up or that you think people should know or that you want our listeners and fans to know?
Nothing is coming to mind. I thought I saw something in the chat earlier that I missed.
So while you're thinking about that, Cult Cardboard does have one more for you. This will probably be the last question. But again, I'm going to give Deanna a chance to say anything she wants to say and say her piece before we move on. If I may ask another question, what game mechanic do you want to see more of? And what's one that you think is overused?
Oh, I would like to see more Moncalas. I dig it in Trajan. I dig it in... Oh, it's not Gold West. It's the other...
Gold West has Mancala. Yeah,
that is it. I am getting it right. Thank you. Gold West. So yeah, I would like to see more Mancala. I dig that. What is overused? I don't know. I mean, we're seeing a lot of trends, but I can't think of anything that's really just sick of it. So I can't think of anything that I'm sick of. So I'm going to pass on that portion of the question. Sorry.
All right. Tech has a request. He's never been taught a game by Deanna. So you have a request for our next Brews and Beers event at the Walkerville Verley happening this month on the 23rd. Quick shout out there for anyone who happens to be local. Next one's on the 23rd. Maybe we'll get Deanna to teach Tech and at least one of his daughters. Maybe you can get both out this week next time to play.
What do you want to learn? Distilled?
How about Trajan?
I don't want to teach Trajan to anyone. I want to play it. I hate teaching that game. Terraform Mars Ares Expedition. I don't mind teaching that one.
All right. I'm going to ask one last question just because I want to know. If you had to send someone to your favorite, the content that you're most proud of from the Tabletop Bellhop.
Good gravy.
The website, the podcast, the YouTube videos, any of it that you've liked or that you were involved with.
That's a hard one. Hey, you know what? That reminds me. You know what stamp I put on the show is the fact that we do mystery games. Because Mo would never touch those. We would have never started doing the murder mystery games. And we keep doing them because I really enjoy playing them, and so does my mom. So I get all the credit for that. The fact that we actually do mysterious packages and stuff. What am I really proud of? I mean, the fact that we've been doing this for, it's almost 6 years, just the fact that we managed to do it continuously, all of that. But let's see, I really liked that episode that we did on Mystery Games, which was one of the first ones where I came and co-hosted. I was proud of that. I thought it turned out pretty good, particularly considering it was one of the first times when I was hosting and I had no clue what the heck I was doing, and I hate reading show notes. You guys have done so many good ones over the years.
Like I should pick the one that I'm not in. Thanks.
Well,
like the first episode,
I'm
not.
That's a valid answer.
No, absolutely.
We put that together in like one afternoon, and
you guys did a fantastic job.
Yeah, I was proud of it. It could have flopped so bad, and it was fine. You guys have done so many great ones over the years, and I usually like the philosophy ones, the ones where you and Mo were less scripted. And I'm just drawing a blank on any specifics because it all merges together into one long thing in my head. We've been doing it for so much.
Yeah, you know, Sean's Kickstarter rant is probably one of our least scripted episodes.
Cult Cardboard, that is such a fantastic game. Sorry, the chat room's talking about their unplayed games right now, and Tech is asking Deanna to teach Hamster Roll. We'll get Genevieve to teach you that one.
No, and I'm not playing Fuse. This is not Torment Deanna.
That's what's next, right? Is your initiation, your hazing. Now that we've done the AMA, we got to do the hazing. All right. Well, thank you everyone in the chat room for the awesome questions. Thank you those of you who aren't here who gave us questions ahead of time on Discord. Greatly appreciated. I hope everyone just got to know Deanna a little bit better. Next, a message from our sponsor. So one of the things we look forward to every year is attending the Origins Game Fair in Columbus, Ohio, which is coming up. June 19th to 23rd. All three of us are attending, and we've got lots to look forward to.
One of those things that we're looking forward to is a chance to meet up with our awesome sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. We love checking out their booth and seeing what they're showing off, as well as just getting to meet with Mark in person. This year, they're going to be at booth 1233, and we encourage all of you to stop by. And if you do, be sure to tell them that the Bellhop sent you.
At Origins this year, Grand Gamers Guild will be highlighting Endangered Rescue Number 1, Galapagos Penguins. The first in a new series of 18-card escape room-style games from Jonathan Schaefer, as well as his latest holidays hijinks game, The Marriage Mix-Up. The Endangered American Red Wolf Scenario Box, La Familia Hort, and Tirnanog.
Every year, Board Game Geek puts up an Origins Game Fair preview page, which lists all the games premiering at that game convention. Now, this includes these great sounding games and expansions from Grand Gamers Guild. So something I would like and something you can all do to help say thank you to Mark for sponsoring our show is to go to that list and thumbs up the games we just mentioned. You can even go there and filter the list by Grand Gamers Guild.
Or just use the link that we just dropped in the chat room, or you can find that link in our show notes.
Well, that's it for our talk with the no longer in the back room, Deanna, our web wizard, Instagram influencer, and heavy gaming champion.
To chat more with her or any of us, just jump on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord, discord.tabletopbellhop.com, and start up a conversation there.
One quick announcement before we move on to talking about the games we've been playing, and this is another achievement that we have to thank Deanna for.
Just in case you missed the announcement last week, we have officially launched the Tabletop Bellhop merch store.
I feel like you could more thank our kid who does the art than you could me, but I did finally get it set up. So you can find it at tabletopbellhop.com/merch.
We've got nice big 15-ounce Tabletop Bellhop gaming podcast mugs. We've got bellhop and game-inspired t-shirts, golf shirts, and more.
If there's something you would be interested in with our logo on it and you don't see it there, let us know. We'll see what we can do.
For a limited time, if you buy any two items or more and use the code TABLETOP, you'll get free shipping up to a $25 value towards shipping in the U.S. and Canada.
And now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games we've been playing lately.
So first up was another brews and board games event at the Walkerville Brewery. I'm glad to see that our first event wasn't a total fluke. While the place wasn't quite as packed, we had a great turnout. And more importantly to us, the bar was very happy with the results. And it was great to see everyone playing games, enjoying it, eating, drinking. It seemed great. It was awesome to see some people that were there last month come back out. That is always great. We love regulars and repeat customers. And seeing large number of new people who had never been out before. Some stuff we worked on, some things we need to fix, like making sure it's clear that it is a free event and letting people know they don't have to rent the games. So that is something we learned that we have to be a little more clear on next time, because I think people are just used to going to board game cafes where you need to pay to play. Well, that's not the case here. So we are going to be back on May 23rd, and I hope to see more of the same and more people out than last month. Anything either you want to say before we get on to actual gameplays?
While not as crowded as that initial holiday event, it was fantastic to see so many people out, both with their own games and those people who just took part in the Bellhop's offerings.
Well, I did spend most of the night hosting. I did play a few short games, mostly as part of teaching them. A lot of games where I like played one round and then got away. And there were a couple games I played because, the game needed three players or four players or five players. So I ended up filling in the spot. This included the flicking game Icecool, which actually I really enjoy. I hadn't had that one out in a long time. I'm so glad we set that up at the beginning of the night because it got played multiple times. So I think we probably could have took it down a little earlier than we did, but it was nice to see multiple different groups playing it.
Yeah, I have no interest in playing Icecool, but it is super eye-catching, and it was a good idea putting it out, and there were lots of people enjoying it over the evening.
Yeah, I think there's definitely something to be said about making sure there are games out and set up for people to dive into, as well as having the board game buffet for people to peruse.
Boop played once, taught multiple times. Actually, that was probably, remember the last event, it was Catch the Moon. Everyone was playing Catch the Moon. This time it was Boop. Boop was constantly out on a table or two. Why couldn't it be on two? But with a group or two. Theme just catches people's attention. It's a quick one to teach. And actually, we played this at the Sandwich Brewery, just Deanna and I. And I've got to say, like, not only are the crowd, the locals enjoying it, but like, this is just a really good game. Like, the two of us sat down. Highly competitive play of Boop. And unfortunately, I got distracted and lost. It was a close game.
Oh, is that your excuse? That was a long game of Boop. We kept it going for quite a while. That made me want to break it out on date nights more often. I actually super enjoy that game. I get embarrassed when Mo brings these games out that looks like toddlers should be playing them. Like the first time he brought out Mountains Over Molehills, I'm like, do we need to play this in public? It looks like a kid's game. I for some reason that makes me uncomfortable. So Boop, I'm like, cute thing with the bedspread and little cats. I'm like, could we play a game that looks like a real game and maybe not play Boop at the bar? But no, I've kind of gotten over that. Now I just want to play Boop all the time. I also taught Boop to a table of folks at Walkerville. It is such a cute and easy game to sell people on. And I hadn't played it in a while because this is the timeline is Walkerville first, then Mo and I going out. So I actually screwed up while explaining the rules to them, went aside, checked with Gwen, went, oh, I got that rule wrong, and had to run over and tell them, no, no, no. When you trade it in, it's three cats, not one. But they're like, yeah, we already figured it out from the rule book. We knew you were wrong. And I'm like, okay, thank you.
Interestingly, one thing I learned from that event was that Boop can't be on the front edge of the table. It needs to be in the middle of the games because we have this wonderful family who's really energetic and loves playing games, but their youngest wants the cat game all the time. So out of sight, out of mind helps the family a little bit when they drop by.
Yeah, I'm almost wondering if we should grab something. I don't know what we still have from the kids, but there's got to be something like Yuri Gouda or something we still have around the house just to bring, just in case someone shows up with some really young kids, something toyetic they can just, you know, go in a corner and play with.
Unfortunately, I'm saying shove
kids in the corner.
No, no. Just unfortunately, we donated or gave to friends all of our little kids' games. Yeah, I don't think we really have anything left, but I'll take a look.
Next, Hey, That's My Fish. Played once, taught two other times. Still dig this game. It's what I like about this one. It's a pain to set up. I hate having to set up the board every time. But other than that, once it's set up, it's a great game. But what I love about this game is it just seems like the silly kids game without much strategy to it until you realize you can cut other people off. And there was this group playing it, and they were, I don't know, they were drinking. They were having a good time, and they were hoping to play Break the Ice. I don't know if you remember the classic Break the Ice, but they're like, oh, I thought that was the Penguin game. So they sit down playing this one, and they're just like laughing. Yeah, yeah, we moved. And they're like, wait a minute. Wait, does that mean I can only collect those? I'm cut off now? I'm like, yeah. And like the entire group then just like started leaning in and was taking Hey, That's My Fish very seriously. There was some ribbing and joking going on and some take that. And thankfully, they hadn't had too much for things to get nasty, but there were a bit of bad feelings in the game. And as soon as they finished, they're like, oh, now that I know this game, we're going to play again. And I'm totally going to get you this time. It was pretty amusing.
Oh, that game can get vicious. And I played it a lot with Gwen when she was younger. I think I even had an app on my phone. So if we're ever like killing time at an appointment or something, we'd play it. And when she once she realized that you could be nasty in that game and you could do mean things to mom, It became her favorite game for a while there. I also taught Rec Raiders to some folks. It went over well. It's an easy game. People are shocked to learn that it's from kids' table board games and is a kids' game. Well, it's not really a kids' game per se. It's a family weight game. But yeah, it went over well.
See, I think that's the main reason Kids Table Board Game changed to KTBG. It's just so you don't have gamers stumping their nose at it. Point Salad was another one. I played one round with a couple and then let them take off after that. And they did like the full two-player game, I think like four or three times in a row. Big hit. That's one of the ones I think that's going to be like a permanent part of our menu, right? Mm-hmm. I might even move it over to the classic game section at some point because like I don't see a reason not to bring that game.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I find it really easy to pitch to people, like when they're up at the table and they're looking for something, and if they're just two players and they just want something, they want to have a drink and play a game. That one's so easy to just play and have a social experience with because you don't have to have that overly focus. And there's certain people who, as they walk up, I can get that vibe. And if Point Salad's there, they're probably going to get that recommendation.
Yeah, the chat's backing this one up too. The Eggman's noting it's always in my game bag along with Scout and Cockroach Poker, which there's two games we need to play, especially Scout, since supposedly we reviewed it. Played matches with a fan of the show, Kevin, and his daughter, one of my kids, and my mother-in-law. Huge hit. I knew my mother-in-law would like this one, Deanna's mom. It's Kevin also seemed to enjoy it. Just this game, there's just something about this game. Like if you like traditional card games, you're going to love matches. Amusing story about matches. Our sponsor reached out to me today, Mark from Grand Gamers Guild, to ask if he should publish matches. And I had to say, sorry, Mark, you're a little late. That one's already out. So Thing 12 Games beat you to it. So I thought that was kind of funny that Mark actually reached out and was like, that matches sounds good. Do you think I should publish it?
You definitely should. It's good.
Yeah. I'm like, yeah, you should, except someone beat you to it.
Yeah, I wasn't surprised that my mom loved the game. But I was surprised because our youngest daughter, Jen, was insisting that her grandmother go try this game. And that amused me because Jen didn't actually seem to like matches that much at first. But she was like, no, no, Mim, you need to come over here. You need to play this. And like, I'm always secretly pleased when she's bold enough to go and sit play with strangers. And like I was talking about this a bit earlier during the AMA, seeing the kids interact with different people is something that I love about these public play events. Like seeing my oldest daughter there teaching game to strangers. And as I said before, I would not have been doing that at age 16. I like that these events facilitate that. And I think they facilitate it not just for our kids, but for other people that are mixing and mingling and playing with different people.
So I actually even got a teach in at the game night. We were wrapping things up and getting towards the end of the night, and things had been reasonably calm, or calmer than we had in our first night. So I had a little bit of time, and Kevin and his daughter wanted to play with something. And I know they like co-op games. So I taught them the A.R.T. project. And especially since we had three players, I think it went really well. Tech said his daughter really loved it. I don't know if Tech did, but we did win. But again, that three-player number for the A.R.T. project is just kind of the magic spot for it.
Yeah, I agree on that one. Check out our review from last week for more info on the A.R.T. project.
Yep. I third that. Three is the magic number.
There, Tech also said it was such a great game. There it is. Yeah. It's got a great flow to it that's really solid. That and a game we're going to talk about tonight were surprising me for how tight and just smooth and enjoyable they are.
I also sat and played Zensu with Gwen in between greeting and teaching people, and she's played it enough times with me now that she's getting really frustrated that she hasn't won yet. And I was like, just relax, just play that. And she was also kind of frustrated because I wasn't taking the game very seriously. I was like chatting in between and going and talking to people. She'd be like, take your turn. I want to play this game.
Later in the night, once there weren't really any new people showing up, I sat down and played Medium with a couple of our regulars, Joe and Dave, and that went really well. Ends up, I guess we had caught the entire bar's attention. I didn't quite realize we were that loud at the time. I will say this event was quieter than last time. Last event, we had games like Headbands going and a few laugh out loud games. Well, Medium was about the only one that got played this time. So sorry if I bothered anyone else who was playing anything, but Medium still proved to be extremely popular. I think that's one I'm going to try to push more. Like I'll have Sean at the table saying, you know, if you got a group that doesn't, you know, want, needs a get to know you game, or it's almost like an option instead of psychobabble that's a little easier to explain. I think we're going to have to try to push that one more because I think people enjoy it. And I think it's worth having at least one table playing a loud, raucous game for when people come in and they get to hear people having fun. I ended the night with a huge 12-player game of Telestrations, finally putting my 12-player version of the game to almost its full use. This was literally, the bar was going to close. We got in one round, which was awesome. We all drew. We all went around the table. Everyone showed off their books and had a great time. That game is always a good hit.
Yeah, and while that was going on, Dee and I got in a game of Go Cuckoo to wrap things up for the night. And, well, I won, but Dee doesn't like Dex games, so.
I hadn't played this one in a long while. It's still fun. It's okay for a Dex game. I still suck at it.
Next up, no longer at the game night, just games we played this weekend, which there was quite a bit in the last week. First play of Fantastic Factories. Now, we played a short demo of this at Origins. This is the first time playing my copy. Game is so quick. It was just Deanna and I were at the Sandwich Brewery. We were instantly hooked. We played at least one more round. It might have been two. I think we might have played three times in a row. This is a very quick playing engine builder where you're drafting a building, hiring a contractor. Then everyone rolls dice and plays for a work phase simultaneously. Super quick, super tight, but we're reviewing this one later, so I'm not going to say too much more now.
Yeah, it's just simple yet engaging. It's easy to pick up. It's easy to teach. It's meaty enough to be a game. When we were finished, I wanted to have another go at it.
Yep. And honestly, like we played this like that. That was the first time this weekend. I played this half dozen times in the last week, which is ridiculous. This is going to be the quickest game I've gotten from unboxing to reviewed. The unboxing just went live today. For those of you who follow our YouTube channel, you can go watch it right now. And we're going to be reviewing it later tonight. So we've also played, Dee and I played, we played a couple of rounds with Sean at Chapter 2. We had a big 5-player game at Brenda's. And like I said, we're already ready to share this one with the world. Next, Deanna and I tried out Matches with only 2 players. And I got to say, here's the one time where I'm like, man, I don't know that I'm loving it. Danny, I love your game. Add 3 players or more. 2 players, just, I don't know. It was playable. the rules work. It was just too tight and too cutthroat, and it was way too easy to just fold, to do the math and look and go, well, if I fold now, you get 1 point and I get my pair. If I can't make any more pairs, I might as well fold. On a positive note, game was done in like 10 minutes. This, honestly, I hate to say it because we usually complain about two-player variants, kind of felt like one was needed here.
Folding consistently being the better option than pushing your luck does not make for a fun experience. It might be savvy. Yeah. It might get you the game, but it's no fun. And I don't like to house rule games that we're reviewing, but this needs something to fix it at two, or just take the two-player right off the box.
Big one to hit the table this weekend, heavy one. Check out me trying to lift that one on our Instagram page, is Hamburg. This was the actual first game in the new Queen Game City series, featuring games from Stefan Feld. We've already reviewed Marrakesh. That's actually, I think, the fourth game in the series. This one is an update and retheme to Bruges, which many people consider Feld's best game. And it's not my favorite Feld, but I do understand why people love it. What kills me about this is how heavy it is. Like I am pretty sure this is heavier than Gloomhaven before I put the insert in. Once I put the wooden insert in, Gloomhaven wins. But it's not one of those giant queen coffin boxes either. It's just dense. There is a lot of cards, cardboard, and wood.
They stuffed it with lead bricks. Like, it's a smaller box than Gloomhaven, but it is heavier. I loved it. I mean, I shouldn't be surprised, but my memories of playing Bruges are that I was ho-hum on it, including one rather horrible digital play that we did with Sean. So I was not super excited to get a retheme of Bruges to the table.
Yeah, my only experience with Bruges was that digital play on one of the non-board game arena digital implementations. Mm-hmm. And it was not how to learn the game. I would say it went even more poorly than my first experience with Arnak, which I had fun at, but I really missed some of the parts of the game. Bruges, I didn't have fun, and I think I missed large parts of the game.
Oh, yeah.
It was just an all-around bad experience.
Yeah, I was worried because I think Bruges is really good. I it's not my favorite Feld, but it's up there, like top 10, top 5, possibly top 3. And I was like, oh, man, like I can't believe Dee didn't like that. It's totally her type of game. So I'm glad to hear that she did enjoy this one. While it's here, I saw it. One thing that was interesting, I'm just going to give you a pro tip that with the City series. So I saw this with Marrakesh, but I didn't catch it till the end. All of the expansion content is put on different punch boards. Thank you, Queen. That is brilliant. But there was nothing noting that. Like, I missed it with Marrakesh. So, like, I punched everything, and then we're trying to sort it. And we're like, why are there more oases here than there should be? Oh, that's part of an expansion. So pro tip, if you buy anything in the series, just don't go punch everything and group similar items. Wait till you've got it sorted. So I actually, my copy of Hamburg has the expansion stuff still on the punch board because I figure why punch it now? Now, another thing that I learned about the City series, which again, this was in Marrakesh, but Marrakesh was a brand new game, right? So I expect this, is this series doesn't just re-theme and reprint the original games. Like, yes, they tweak some rules, but it's not even just that. What it also has is all of the expansion content, all those queenies, any separate expansions, and maybe even some new stuff. This part I can't confirm because I don't have all the queenies and everything for Bruges. So what I like about this is enough to tempt someone who has the old game to get the new one. And honestly, the reason I asked to review Hamburg is because I own Bruges. I wanted to be able to compare the two games. I wanted to be able to go, why should someone who likes Bruges pick up Hamburg? And well, one of the reasons is you get 6 expansions in the box.
A thing I think we were both surprised by is how big the board is. We ended up having to move to a different table to make the game fit. And even then, it was a bit of a hog. They made some interesting choices with places for everything on the board, including expansion stuff that you don't touch in the base game. So you just end up with a much larger board than was technically necessary. There's also like a rather large chunk of the board is a space to place each color of worker. And for most table setups, I think it's probably easier to have those off to the side in a pile or preferably in a bowl, something that lets you spread the game out in different directions based on where you're sitting is probably more practical than a really massive board for... You said it when we were talking about it, when we were laying it out, maybe they were trying to make it look deluxe, but it seems to be a trend that the meatier a game is, the larger the table space for games that don't necessarily need to be that much of a table hog.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, in this case, it's weird because the original Bruges has a very small board. But this did have a place for everything. There was a place to put your money. There was a place to put each of the five different colors of worker. Even a rather large space to store the five dice you're rolling. But like, it's a huge chunk of the board to put these dice on. And honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw a Hamburg Essential Edition, kind of like we saw a Marrakesh. Like, obviously, this was a design choice with this new series, was to make the games big. And I'm not sure it was the right choice. Now, I will say this will probably fit on my kitchen table, unlike Marrakesh, which is barely playable at two. But it is way larger than you'd expect it to need to be.
Yeah, I struggle with this because, you know, we talked about Marrakesh and how there's use to the spaces and things like that. But even that, you know, there's still a lot of essentially wasted space on Marrakesh. The stairs up the, are way bigger than they need to be. And, you know, there's a lot of that sort of expansive space taken up. And in the case of Marrakesh, it's not even, you know, beautiful graphics. We're not talking about Vincent Dutre or, you know, Tool graphics here. It's the stairway, and things like that, where they could really find some way to trim that down. Now, obviously, you've got, you know, standard board sizes that you need to deal with and you want to keep within to keep your costs down. But in some ways, the Essential makes a lot more sense.
I would argue that Marrakesh looks utilitarian in its spacing and layout compared to Hamburg.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you thought Marrakesh was bad, wait till you see Hamburg. Like, really, it's excessive. Now, as far as game, okay, at this point, I would say it's as good as Bruges. It might be better. I'm not sure. So here's the big change. And if you're a hardcore fan of Bruges, you're going to love or hate this. And I think this is going to be the deciding factor for anyone who owns the original, more so than just you get some expansions. What you get in this is you divide all five types of cards into separate decks that are shuffled. And when you draw cards, you get to pick which color to get. So the whole thing with Bruges, one of the big new mechanics in it was you had a stack of two cards and you would shuffle both decks and you could draw one at a time off each deck. You always had two color choices. Sometimes it'd be the same. That's gone now. You literally get the color you want. So you have way more control and agency and less randomness. You're never going to be like, oh, I need a big pink building. I hope a pink building comes up. No, if you need a pink building, you take a pink building. And I think it's better, but I don't know. Like I that old mechanic I thought was a lot of fun. That whole, it sometimes I liked it when I couldn't get what I wanted and then had to figure out a different way to spend my turn effectively. I'm missing that in this new version. Now, honestly, we played one game, so I'm going to save the rest of my thoughts for after we played a bit more. Do you have anything more to add, Deanna, before we move on to the next game?
Everything you just said about the color picking, I pretty much feel the same way. I'm really kind of on that. I think that was a core mechanic to Bruges, and I'm not sure I like that they changed it. But I loved the game, so I can't wait to play it again. But be prepared to be constantly referring to the appendix over and over again as you figure out what the various cards do. The iconography isn't bad, but it certainly isn't clear enough for you to just be able to look at it and figure it out on the first go. And I'm going to tell a little story because this was amusing to me. So when we were playing Fantastic Factories, it was at a pub and it was our first time playing. And we had to reference the rule book a few times. And there was a woman sitting at the table next to us. She came up to me in the washroom and asked me about the game we were playing and said, "Whoa, it must be really complex because I keep seeing you guys look up the rules and asking each other about the rules." And I said, "Oh, no. This is an easy game. This is just our first play." And she sounded so relieved. Like, now the game wasn't frightening and now she was intrigued by it and wanted to know what we were doing. And then I had the same experience when we were playing Hamburg, because we were playing at a different brewery and we were referring to the rule book a ton. Though in this case, I would say we're going to be continuing to do that. It wasn't just because it was our first play, but someone said, "Wow, that game must be so hard. I keep seeing you look at the rules." So now I kind of feel guilty, like maybe we're doing a disservice by playing these games in public because we're scaring people off as we're sitting there debating rules and looking at rule books and saying, "What do you think this means?"
All right, next up, we got Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay Elector Counts back to the table. This one has been unfortunately buried in the front room. I've been slowly clearing things out, making more room in there and moving things down to the shelves and so on. And finally, you got one of the back corners so you can finally get to. So this is our first play since Origins. And when we played at Origins, it wasn't a great experience, but it was the end of the night. We were all burnt out and I was trying to do the bad thing and crack the game open, crack the shrink at the table and tried to read the rule book. And I've got to say, there's a thing with RPG writers writing board game rule books. They're just not used to writing board game rule books. They're used to writing RPG rule books. And I feel this game has that. And it was not the best experience at Origins, I will say.
Okay, we were talking, people asked me earlier about games I didn't want to sit down and play. Here's one, because I did not have a good experience with that first play, but I was willing to admit that my negative feelings towards the game might be because I was burnt out at the end of a very long day. So we did give it another shot, but I was begrudging to play this one. I could have thought of, you know, 10 other things that I'm pretty sure we must play before this one.
Yeah, and I think part of my problem is... the same as everyone else. It was the end of a long day. We were all tired. It was late at night. And we just trekked all the way across the entire show floor just to find a table and to crack open the game. But I've also had less than stellar experiences with a lot of the little box GW games. They haven't always really sort of caught me. As much as I love Warhammer Fantasy, their games haven't always done it for me. And so I probably not only was tired and cranky, but had a sort of a bad opinion of it going in.
Which really isn't fair because Games Workshop hasn't made those games in years, right? This is Cubicle 7 who made this one, which has nothing to do with Games Workshop, except they got the Warhammer license. And actually, this is a retheme of a Doctor Who game that they rethemed into Warhammer. So a Games Workshop had very little to do with it. But either way. I'm happy to say this was a much better experience. There's definitely a solid game here. It's very much a tug of war back and forth. Game made more sense and actually played really well two players. Now, I did notice that Board Game Geek has it listed at best at two. And that could have been one of the problems, too, is the first time we played, we tried to play with three.
It was okay. I think it does play well at two. I got a little nervous when I saw that there was alternate rule set for two players, but just you take out like three or four cards that wouldn't work well with two. I would play it again. It still feels a bit fiddly to me. I do love the art and the Warhammer-ness of it.
Yeah, the big problem I had with it, though, was I think you need to learn the game. Like it reminds me a bit of Battleline for anyone who's played Battleline before, because you're kind of playing things on two sides. You're putting down terrain. Are building sites and people are playing cards at them, either defenders and attackers, and it's trying to control those sites. So it's very similar to Battleline that way, but with a drafting mechanic. So what happens every turn is you keep going until you only have three cards left in your hand, and then you give them to your opponent. And there's where it's best at two, I think, is you're handing cards back and forth. There's no way going around the table. So you know exactly what three of the cards are your opponents have. But the thing is, if you don't know the cards in the deck, that's not going to help too much. You don't know if you're giving them something good or bad until you played a few times. And more importantly, there are some very, very specific cards that are like, if you play this card against this card, it defeats it instantly. Well, you have to know that card's there. And like the only situation that's going to come up is when you've drafted the one card and you got both in your hand and you give the other card to the other player. And then they happen to put a thing down. Like, I have a feeling that once you get to a certain level with this game, it could almost be a chess-like experience, but you got to get to that level.
Yeah, it feels like a game that really requires a level of mastery, knowing the cards, being aware of what you handed to your opponent, what's possibly in the deck. I feel like this game requires more work than I'm willing to put into it.
Yeah, no, there's definitely a potential, again, with that, even if it's not GW, Warhammer aesthetic, where Warhammer itself lends itself to, lifestyle games and lifestyle gamers, you know, this may lean in that direction as well. And to be honest, none of us play games often enough, a specific game often enough to really get that level of mastery anymore since we're reviewing stuff.
Yeah, personally, okay. We got to play this one. We need to review it. This is we got this at Origins, and if it wasn't for the flood, it'd probably be done. But the flood's done. I can get to the game now. We got to get this done. I'm actually looking forward to playing again, and I think Sean will enjoy it more two player. I did enjoy the Warhammerness and recognizing specific characters, and there wasn't a lot of interactions that were like, oh, well, actually the Halfling one was pretty funny. Like just knowing the characters and the locations was pretty cool. I think there's a good game here. I just think it's going to really appeal to Warhammer fans and, like Sean said, people who make it a lifestyle game, who play this all the time.
I can't say I'm looking forward to playing it, but I'm more willing now and I don't need to be coerced.
There you go. Bandigoo's monthly mug club. Deanna played a full two-player game of Point Salad. It was really close. I did great 2 out of 3 rounds, but she trounced me in the middle. Just game's good. We already kind of called it out earlier. Everyone in the chat's like, yeah, I keep a copy with me. Just such a great game.
Yeah, it's the perfect pub game. Small footprint, doesn't require focus to play. I love the way that the two-player game breaks it into 3 rounds and you eventually go through the entire deck. It's just a winner.
We also broke out Targi, which we are still loving. At some point, we got to get Sean to play this one, either against me or you or whatever, one of us watching, so he can share his thoughts. But at this point, once Sean tries it, I think we're ready for a full review. And I got to say, at this point, mine's going to be very positive. I have very little negative to say about this game.
I'm loving Targi. I want to pimp it out with all the deluxe geek bits and bring it to date night always. I think I want to play Sean because maybe I'll be able to beat Sean since I never win at this game when I play it against Mo, but I still really dig it.
Speaking of getting to play with Sean, I did introduce him to Dragon Dice. The classic TSR game brought back to life from SFR games. And he didn't like that one much.
Yeah, I didn't. I never played Dragon Dice back in the 90s. I never even played the video game for it back in the 90s. I didn't have any fond memories of rolling dice in armies against each other. Hey, let's just play this game. Here's some dice. Now study this rule book because every one of these dice looks different, is a different size, has different abilities, and has completely different iconography on it than the dice I'm going to use over here. And you have to know what all of that iconography is. Oh, and here's the 7-page spell book. It was a bit much. It was overwhelming and kind of drained the fun out of the experience. Now, I get it. If you love this game in the 90s, if you've got fond memories of this game, if you want to get a set and sit down and build your army and learn the iconography, I can see it. The fun is there. There's definitely some really interesting tactics involved. Don't ever just push this on someone, though, because there are some real overwhelming issues when it comes to their choices in iconography and dice sizes and things like that. It's it's a lot.
Yeah, and this is their introductory game, right? Like, this is the two-player starter set with the easy basic rules to learn. So I don't know. It's an older style of game that requires a level of dedication that modern board games, you know, you can just sit down and play and have a good time your first play. That is not this, right? It's a game from a different era, and it definitely does still have that feel.
To me, realistically, it was the iconography that really put me off of it. Mo kept telling me that there were faces on these dice, and I never, throughout the entire time we were sitting there, identified some of what he told me were faces as faces, no matter what angle I looked at them. And you know, little things like, you know, footprints are the movement icon, but every race has a different footprint, and the footprints of the treemen look almost exactly the same as the clubs of the treemen, which are almost exactly the same as the spears of the treemen. That iconography, again, because I was just sitting down and trying to figure out, even with the basic rules, the fact that all of these icons looked almost exactly the same made for a really rough play.
Note to self, swap the armies next time if I'm going to sit down and introduce the game to someone. Because like I say, the other army, it's a lot easier to see the difference between the icons. But yeah, like you pointed out, I don't quite get. Like, I don't know, someone at TSR thought it was cool, but I don't get why they didn't use a standard shield attack melee magic symbols. Like, or sorry, melee missile attack. Like, there's no reason not to have, really. Yeah.
The dice color makes all the difference. Like, once you've got the different color dice, the icons can be the same. Unless they had plans for some distant future where the symbols would be on different dice and mean different things. I don't know.
I don't think so. I just think someone thought it'd be cool that the orc feet look different than the dwarf feet, which look different than the treemen feet. And the dwarf weapons would look different than the orc weapons, which look different. I think that's all it was. Last one for this last week. Told you, a lot of games. 4-player game of KAPOW. This is from Wise Wizard Games. It's another one that unfortunately got buried with the flood that I was finally able to get back out. So we sat down with both volume 1 and 2, which is the only way to play this game with four players. Note, you cannot play three. It is a 4 or 2 player game. We use the 2-player team rules, and they're good. They're really good. Now, I like the 2-player game. I really like the 2-player game. I think it is a fantastic superhero dueling game. I will say I enjoy it more than Marvel Dice Throne. I really dig this one. I like the engine building. I like the modifying my dice. I don't know. There's interesting decision points. Do you defend? Do you attack? And absolutely adore the asymmetry. 4-player, though, it was even better. Like it just, I wasn't expecting team play to be better than 2 when I already enjoyed 2.
Yeah, I have to say, I was blown away. This was a fantastically solid game where I could, you know, the game was good. KAPOW was fine. I probably leaned a little bit more towards Marvel Dice Throne myself, yeah. Until we played this version, until we played this cooperative team, and KAPOW really took the lead. This is the way to play it so far. I mean, it's wonderful.
Yeah. The only thing I want to do is at some point, Sean and I should probably sit down and try the co-op mode where you can play teams cooperative. So you play 2 heroes versus a villain or 2 villains versus a hero. And every single one of those asymmetric boards, every character is a different cooperative or solo game. So we'll try out that, and then we'll be ready to review it. But I've got to say, Mike, it's not often that we try the weird variant that needs 2 boxes where you have to work in teams. Or like we found a better game than the original. I guess Mind Your Business was another recent example of that for me.
Now, I know we got this a while back at Origins last year, and I remember when... Oh, I'm blanking on her name. Is it Deborah? Yeah, Debbie from Wise Wizard Games gave us the 2 boxes of KAPOW. She was really excited to give us the 2nd box. She's like, you're going to like the team play. So yeah. She was kind of giddy about it. So I guess she was onto something there.
And that is it for our lengthy. There's no event this week. So next Wednesday when you come in, it shouldn't be quite as bad.
Fantastic Factories is a fantastic, quick-to-learn, very pure engine-building game that has won all of us over.
Fantastic Factories comes from the design team of Joseph Z. Chen and Justin Faulkner and features some awesome 70s-style artwork from Joseph himself. It was originally published by Deepwater Games, who's now going by Friendly Skeleton Games, and who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy of this engine builder.
This tableau builder plays 1 to 5 players and is super quick because players do their actions simultaneously. Even at a full player count, games tend to clock in at less than an hour. Almost every time we sit down to play Fantastic Factories, because of the short play time, we usually end up playing 2 or 3 games in a row.
Now, while the game is listed as 14+, we can see younger players enjoying it. The community on Board Game Geek has it listed as 10+, and we think you could probably even go a bit younger than that. However, despite being quick to learn with simple mechanics, the game does have some weight to it.
So the gist of Fantastic Factories is pretty simple. Build factories, train your workers, and make as many goods as possible as quickly as possible. Each round, you either hire a contractor or grab the blueprints for a new building. Roll your worker dice. Spend your dice on standard actions like drawing cards, producing resources. Build cards and activate those cards to generate resources or goods. At the end of the game, add the number of goods you've made to the value of your factories to figure out who won.
You can check out the fantastic card art and the excellent iconography of Fantastic Factories through our unboxing video over on YouTube.
Now, the quality here is great and honestly more than you would expect. The player's HQ boards are dual layered, and the game comes with a custom box insert. The instructions are very clear and include a reference for the more complicated cards. The card quality is also great.
And one of the best features of Fantastic Factories is how quick you can get it to the table and how simple it is to learn. Start a game by having everyone pick a set of 4 dice and grabbing a headquarters board. Shuffle up the blueprint cards and deal 4 to each player. Then set the deck on the table and deal it a market of 4 cards. Next, shuffle the contractors, deal out a similar 4-card market, placing a type token above each of them. Place all the resources and good tokens to the side, have each player grab 1 metal and 3 energy, and you're good to go.
Each round starts with a market phase where players either draft a blueprint or hire a contractor. Before drafting, the active player has the option to spend 1 resource to discard and refill one of the two markets, either the contractors or the blueprints.
Blueprints are free, but the contractors have to be paid by discarding a card from your hand, matching the token above that contractor. Some contractors also require additional cost in energy. Contractors do all sorts of things like getting you more cards or resources, giving you extra dice in the work phase, and more.
Next is the work phase, which is the bulk of the game. First, players roll all their dice plus any bonus dice they earned from contractors. They then have a bunch of options. Dice can be placed on the HQ board. Any die gets you a card. Three or less gets you energy equal to the die value, and four or more gets you one metal. You also get a bonus extra thing if you play a pair, or a bonus of two if you play a set of three matching dice.
You can also build factories in the work phase. You discard a card of the same type from your hand, pay the listed cost, and place the card you want to build into your tableau. Each building is worth points, which start at zero and go up from there. In general, you can't build two of the same building, though there are some exceptions, like obelisks.
The final thing you can do in the work phase is activate your factories. You can activate each card in your tableau once. Most have a cost on the left and a benefit listed on the right. Some will give you additional dice, many will give you resources, and a few will generate goods, which are crates. Some factories provide you with new places to place your dice as well.
So what's important to know here is that you can do any of those things in the work phase any number of times in any order, which gives Fantastic Factories a strong puzzle feel. Like you can spend a die to draw a card, hoping to get one that matches the type of card in your hand. Then use another die to get some energy and use that energy with some metals to play that card. Then use that card to get a bonus die and combine that die with another one you have to activate a building to generate two crates. It's those kind of moves.
Once any player has played at least 10 buildings or has generated at least 12 crates, you then play one more round and add up your points. It's as simple as adding the number of crates you have to the victory point value of your factories. The player with the most points wins, and ties go to whoever has the most leftover resources.
So Fantastic Factories is simple. The depth comes from the cards themselves, what they do, and how they interact. Fitting the theme, everyone is working to build a combination of different buildings that work together to create a crate-making factory.
Now, Deanna and I first tried this game at Origins Game Fair and were instantly hooked after only a short demo. I remember it being the last Sunday of the con and both of us being exhausted, and Deanna actually being a little reluctant to try it at the time, but I convinced her to sit down.
I did not want to demo anything else. I was done. I was totally done. The only thing that got me to play this game is that there was a chair involved. But I really loved it. And the guy that was demoing it had so much energy. And I for the end of the day, he was doing pretty good, too. So, yeah, I was immediately hooked.
Yeah, well, I'd heard some good things about the game. I really knew nothing about it at all until last weekend when you guys pulled it out.
Yeah, we brought home a review copy from the con. Again, thanks, Deepwater, Friendly Skeleton. Sadly, it didn't get to the table until now because it was buried in our front room with the other games we had to move during the flooding we had. But once it was unburied, I broke it out. We were instantly hooked again. In under a week, we managed to fit in half a dozen games. And even right now, I'm like, well, when can we get together and play Fantastic Factories again?
Yeah, it's true. Let's go. At the end of the recording, we can just break it out and play it anytime.
Yeah, the weight of this one, I love. You need to think about your actions, but you can also have a drink, relax, and chat while waiting for others to draft or finish their actions in the simultaneous phase. A game that has enough weight, but you can still be social during.
Yeah, what I like about it is just how tight it is. Like, just pure. It's I'm going to use that term, elegant. Which I know people sometimes throw around for board games, but it really does fit here. This is a really elegant engine builder that I also found really thematic because it's an engine builder about building engines. And in this case, it's a manufacturing engine. You're taking raw goods and energies to use factories to turn those into a product. Now, don't get the wrong idea when I'm talking about product here. This is not an economic game in any way. This is not about buying or selling the goods, just the engine you need to make them.
I like the tightness and the way you're trying to eke the most out of every turn. It almost reminds me a little bit of Arnak in that way, where you're just going to just do one more thing and just one more thing. And oh, and if I try this and I push my luck here, now I can buy one more. And I love that puzzle aspect of it. And that we're all doing it simultaneously and not bogging each other down with, I don't feel like I'm holding everyone up while I'm figuring this nonsense out.
Yeah. The fact that you can do any of your actions in any order really makes it flexible to allow you to eke out every little action you can. So I will notice, though, that while we called the cards that you're building from blueprints factories, the buildings themselves aren't actually really all factories. There are a couple of sort of factories in there, but the system that you're creating, you are creating a factory out of everything. You're building gyms for your workers, power stations, inspirational monuments, anything to get your factory pumping out those crates.
Yeah, and the game just flows really well and is super quick. That simultaneous play during the work phase is key to this. First, yeah, everyone drafts or activates a card, but then you roll your dice and then it's just you and your cards trying to figure out the best way to use them, trying to solve that puzzle.
Yeah, and the iconography is fantastic, combined with a rule book that we have not found lacking at all yet. Just makes it flow even that much better because you don't have to stop and figure out what things do.
Now, an odd thing about this, which I actually kind of baffles me, is even though you're like, once you roll your dice, it's heads down trying to figure out your own little puzzle, the overall game doesn't feel like multiplayer solitaire, which is something that happens in many engine builders. Now, I know there's expansions out there that actually do add more player interactions and some take that mechanics, but even as the game stands now, I find myself watching my opponents, what they're collecting, drafting specific cards to discard them, not to build what I want, but to deny them from another player.
Yeah, that one drafting action has a lot of impact. And it does, however, become even more impactful the more players you have, as you're seeing things more clearly, I guess.
I feel like you're doing the solo activity and then you have to go do the group thing. And it's not a long break between the two. It's the flow between the, I have to go do the interact with the group. Now I'm doing my solo activity that makes it feel like you're actually playing a game together and don't you know, you still all have to be at the same table.
Now, another highlight of this game for me is the artwork and design. And again, Sean already called out the iconography, just the overall look of it. Like, I remember Sean actually saying, I don't think you've had to Google anything for this one. And no, we haven't. The cards themselves are pretty much that clear. And there's a couple that were like, oh, does this work? Can you do this more than once? Or does that mean this? And the rule book has a reference for every card in it. And every time I've read that reference, I've went, yep, that makes sense. Like, it's never been like, oh, I wouldn't have read that card that way. It's just confirming the bias. Like, yeah, okay, that's what I think this does. Yep, that's what it does. Let's go.
Yeah, for looks, I think it has a really like a 70s picture book feel to it, and I dig that. My only, I guess it's an odd complaint about the components, is I don't see why it had to be dual layer boards, really. It seemed like a waste there to have dual layer boards on this game. It's a silly small complaint, though.
What's interesting there is the first printing of the game instead had a single layer board with holes cut out for the dice. So it still had the effect of a dual layer board, but they upgraded it with the new printing to dual layer. So someone obviously wanted them or they wouldn't have included them.
Yeah, and sadly, I can't think of many games these days where at least one quick trip to the Board Game Geek forums doesn't happen. And that makes this one stand out for its clarity and informative nature and not needing that.
Now, the one thing I don't like about this game, and honestly has nothing to do with the gameplay, is the box insert. It does not do a great job of keeping things separated unless you keep the game flat. And it's even one of those games that did the whole put the punch boards under the insert thing. But if that's helping, it's not helping enough. Every time I've opened this up, I've had to resort the cards. And I'm really tempted to just toss that insert out and switch to baggies just because everything's going to get mixed up anyway.
The insert looks great. It looks like it should do its job. But then as soon as you stand that game up, it's a mess.
Yeah. And for me, I guess the biggest weakness was the initial teach. And not to say anything about Mo and his teaching quality, but they'd been playing it and they were at a certain level of familiarity that I hadn't gotten as, you know, being introduced to it the first time. So there were a couple of little things where the cost and the value weren't making 100 cents. And there are a number of colors on the cards, which don't necessarily mean anything of really. And it kept feeling like they should. After a round, it all clicked into place. The game was obvious from that point on. And it's just, while easy, it shows that how you teach the game is important. Remembering that you are more familiar with it than that new player can go a long way.
To me, Fantactic Factory is just kind of an odd game to me because it's got that meaty engine building Euro mechanisms there. And like it you really feel like you're building something, and that that optimization of your turn and eking out every little action. But at the same time, it feels like a family weight gateway game. Like, it's super accessible, but also rewards game mastery and getting to know the cards. And there's that puzzle aspect that you don't tend to get in games that play less than an hour. Like, honestly, it feels great. And it makes this game that's a nice, quick, it makes it into one of those thinky fillers, right? It's one of those games that is fun, even for experienced gamers, even though it kind of has that family weight feel.
Yeah, I actually think this is the gold standard for family weight level of games. Like, it's going to be fun for gamers to play, and it's just a great welcoming entry-level game, and it's a game that you could play with younger kids.
Yeah, engine builders like this, I find, are kind of their own thing, and they very well may not be for everyone. But I think this game may help some of those who are on the fence. The way the cards interact, power plants, gymnasiums, and actual manufacturing factories working in ways that make sense with each other for this whole goal of making a product, even if that product is just a crate.
Actually, I call that out too. I like the abstract nature of that, right? Like, it's metals, energies, and crates. What are you making? It doesn't matter. You're making crates. Overall, I love it. I love Fantastic Factories. I was so happy to find out that demo we did wasn't a fluke, that, like, we only played a couple rounds. I was like, oh, no, this is good. We want to take a copy of this. And it is that straightforward and good. This was a game I immediately wanted to play again after my first play. And then once we played a few times, we were doing we got to show this one to Sean. Oh, I bet your mom's going to like this. I bet you the kids would dig this game. Oh, I can't wait to bring this to a public play event. Like, I really, it's not often I get a game and I want to show it off, right? Like, to me, this is like the Zensu. Like, we got to tell everyone Zensu, or it's the next Gorinto, right? Like, the game that, this isn't the hidden gem, some of those are. Lots of people have talked about Fantastic Factories, but I'm, like, excited to share it with other people.
Yeah, I'm so happy we did that demo. I'm very curious to try out the expansions for this one, though I was looking at one, it's Sabotage, and I'm not even sure if I wanted to add backstabbing to this game, but I'm curious about it. I think it is, as I said, the perfect family weight game.
Yeah, I think the tight play along with reasonably close scores helps also, because even if you do poorly, you're not punished and left feeling like you didn't even try.
Yeah, I feel like engine building, even just like a tiny, tiny bit, you need to pick up Fantastic Factories. It's fantastic. It's super tight, easy to learn, rewarding game, where at the end you actually felt like you built an engine. It's also lightning quick, and I got to say the timing on it is perfect. I always get the feel like, yes, I want one more turn, but I didn't need it. Like my engine got to that good level and I got to run it just enough that it's satisfying.
Yeah, I think Fantastic Factories is going to appeal to heavier engine builder fans as well. People who dig Food Chain Magnet, Russian Railroads, Terraforming Mars, they're going to find an enjoyable thinky filler here.
Yeah, if you're a solo player, you're probably going to be happy with this, and you might want to give some extra thought to the playmat, as one side is just for solo play, which I think is the more valuable reason to buy the playmat than just setting up the multiplayer side.
Personally, now I'm at the point where I want more. I want to try more. I need to try more. I want to try the expansions. Yes, one adds more player interaction. I don't know how backstabby it is. Maybe we'll find out at Origins. Another one, though, adds asymmetry where you're each from a different industry and each industry plays different. So maybe you find out what your crates are. I don't know. So I am looking forward to con season and hopefully getting to check out the expansions for Fantastic Factories, because I do know many people say it gets even better with the expansions, and I'm waiting. I need to see it because it's pretty dang good already.
That ends our look at Fantastic Factories from Friendly Skeleton Games. This is the hot game for us right now, and we just can't stop playing. What's your new hotness? We'd love to hear all about it in the comments section of wherever you just found this review.
Building factories and reviews about factories can be exhausting work. Keep us motivated and caffeinated with coffee. Buy us a brew at ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop. Welcome to our review of Dubious, a fascinating mashup of light improv role-playing, deception, and deduction from Hobby World and Arcane Wonders, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy.
Dubious comes from Dave Neal and features striking artwork from Marta Ivona, Anton Kavasarov, Svetlana Pikul, Uldrum, and Oleg Yurkov. If you haven't guessed it, this game originally dated from Russia and has been localized by Arcane Wonders. It plays 3 to 6 players and is better the more people you have at the table. Now, while it says it plays in half an hour, we find people often need more time than that to think and take notes. Our games tend to be closer to an hour to an hour and a half.
Well, the game is listed for ages 13 plus. We could see younger folk enjoying this as well, with the trick being to go through all the occupations and secrets with all the players at the table to make sure that everyone knows what each one means.
Now, in Dubious, each player is handed 2 random occupations and 2 random secrets. They pick one of each of these and come up with a character concept that fits their choices. Each round, a question card is revealed and everyone answers that question in character. After 5 questions, players then guess what occupation and secret every other player has. Players get points for correct guesses and for some, but not all of the other players guessing their occupation and secret. The original Dubious box includes 3 eras you can play in: fantasy, Victorian London, and modern.
There's a lot more in the Dubious box than you would expect, which you can see for yourself in our Dubious unboxing video. This includes modifiable player screens and cards for each era, a thick pad of deduction sheets, and even pencils with decent erasers on them.
The artwork here sticks out to me as it's not really necessary at all in this game, but very cool. Everything's drawn in this like Invisible Man style, where all the occupations are just clothing with no people in them. And even the front of the box is done this style. And then the secrets are all just items, like drawings of things. And it just is great for evoking that feeling of mystery. The rulebook here is solid with lots of examples, including a full round of play, so you can kind of see how the game plays before you get it to the table.
To play Dubious, you first pick which era to play in. As Mo mentioned earlier, there's fantasy, there's Victorian London, which could easily be steampunk, and then there's modern. Everyone takes a large hint card for that era and attaches it to their screen behind which they put their worksheet.
3 era-specific cards are added to the question decks, which are randomized. In each game, you will use 2 physical description cards and 3 standard question cards. Each player is given 2 occupation cards and 2 secret cards from the appropriate era decks.
Each player chooses 1 occupation, 1 secret, notes down both sets of cards on their worksheet, because knowing what occupation and secret you didn't choose will help with the deduction part. Then everyone spends a few minutes coming up with a character.
The first question card is then revealed and everyone writes down an answer for that question, and then players read them off in character in turn order.
While the active player is answering, everyone else should be making notes using what they are saying to try and determine which occupation and secret they have and don't have.
This continues for 5 rounds, each round featuring a different question. Then each player summarizes all their answers, reading off their answers to all 5 in a row, 1 by 1 off their sheet. Everyone then makes a final decision on what occupation and secret they think each of the other players has.
In turn, players reveal their guesses and everyone's actual occupation and secret are revealed. Players get 1 point per correct guess that they made. In addition, you get points for every player that guessed your occupation or your secret, as long as it wasn't everyone at the table. If everyone guessed correctly, you get no points.
The player with the most points wins.
So the key thing that makes Dubious work is this scoring system. Because you get no points at all if everyone guesses your occupation or secret, the whole trick is to not be too obvious, to be somewhat dubious. You also get no points if no one guesses right, so you can't be too obscure either, and that's where the fun is. The sweet spot every player is trying to go for is to have all but one other player guess correctly for each their secret and their occupation.
Some of the red herrings that people throw out can be really amusing. It's part of the fun of this game. I also really like the mechanic where you get 3 occupations to pick from, because you know it's not just, oh, this one will be more fun. You get two to pick from, and you only have 1 that you don't know?
Yep.
Oh, I thought it was 3. But anyways, you have 1 that you know no one else at the table is. You have 1 that you know no one else at the table is. You might want to kind of hint that you are, even though you aren't. It's one of the fun aspects of the game.
Yeah, you want to be helpful, but not too helpful, which can be a hard line to walk, depending on the group you're playing with. You're going to want to think about who the others are and what they might take away from your answers.
Now, a big potential problem with Dubious is the fact the game requires on-the-spot thinking and what actually boils down to light improv role-playing. In this game, you're forced to come up with a character concept based on two things, an occupation and a secret. You're then going to have to answer questions in character based on that concept. This makes it a fantastic game for RPG players, but something that may not be as appealing to people without that kind of experience.
I actually think it's a good intro to the concept of role-playing for some people.
Yeah, if the idea of answering questions off the cuff terrifies you, though, don't run away just yet, as answering as if you were someone else can often help assuage some of those fears, and there's no timer running here, so no concern about that sort of pressure.
Now, personally, I don't have any problem with an improv element. I've been role-playing games for way too many years, and what I like is the deduction part of this game. The doubt sowed by the way people answer the questions is fascinating, kind of as Deanna mentioned, and for the most part, you can use logic. At least to narrow down the possibilities. Like, you might not be able to perfectly lock down your final answers, but you can actually use deduction logic. And the game helps facilitate this by having the reminders right on your sheet, right? That is so useful. You have a list of all the occupations in the game and all the secrets right there. So you know what is right in front of you. And as people are answering, you're looking at that sheet and you're going, oh no, there's no way they can be a grave digger because they said this. And oh, there's no way they're the cab driver because they mentioned they wear a suit to work. And it's really neat the way that works. Plus there's, as they mentioned, the fact that what role you aren't. I don't know how many times we played this game where partway through someone realizes they have someone pegged for something they can't possibly be because it's the one you didn't take.
As far as the improv anxiety aspect, I think the fact that they have you write down your answer and you don't make you do it on the spot, you have time to think about it, you write it down, and then you have to say it out loud and present it to the group, that really helps with that.
Cool. Yeah. So this is where I found the score sheet somewhat baffling, as they had all this room for notes, aside from being able to write down your own questions, which was super helpful. What I really wanted from the guessing area was numbers I could circle or cross off or make little stars around or something. Writing wasn't what I wanted.
Now, what I really liked too was the fact there are three areas, right? Three settings, including this box. One of these settings could have been a standalone game. That adds a ton of replayability to the game. Plus, I like the settings are generic enough. You can kind of build on them, right? Like when Dan was listening to something, she talked about using London as steampunk. And there's no reason you couldn't say do modern, but say it's modern, but it's during a zombie apocalypse. And that would actually change some of the people's answers, right? If you're a modern taxi cab driver, what you're wearing might be completely different than what you're wearing during a zombie apocalypse. You could also try mixing and matching stuff, but I got to say that's got to get funky for the hint cards. You probably have to make up your own hint cards that are a mashup of, the fantasy secrets with the modern and doing a Charles DeLint game.
I'm sold. I now want to try the Charles DeLint game.
So while I've only played one era so far, I'm more than comfortable with improv RP, so deciding on my character was effortless, and I was able to spend time on each question crafting what I thought would be the best mix of reality and deception to try and get the right people to guess. Of course, there can be a lot of overlap between the roles and secrets, so what you're sure will be interpreted one way can easily go elsewhere in the mind of others.
Now, longtime fans of the show know I'm not normally a social deduction game fan, so I was leery of this one when we took it home. One of the things that won me over, though, is the fact that it is part role-playing game. I am way more comfortable playing a character who may need to mislead other people than playing a game where I'm forced to directly lie to my friends as me. Added to that is the fact you probably don't have to lie at all, really, because Dubious is more about trying not to be too obvious in misdirection that it is about complete falsehoods. Plus, there's no team here, right? You don't get that werewolf thing of people playing favorites. You're not picking anyone. You're not voting on anything. You're just trying to guess what the other players are. And honestly, this has so little in common with other social deduction games. I don't even want to group them with other social deduction games, but that is where everyone seems to have put this game.
Yeah, when we first got it and you said, it's a game, it's called Dubious, it's a social deduction game, I went, no, why? I don't even want to do that. But it is so much more than that. And I don't know what to call it because it does have a deduction aspect, but it's more of a logical deduction. I don't know.
Yeah, it's hard to place to call this social deduction, despite the fact that it is what it is. But as Mo said, it's just a very different kind of social deduction from Werewolf or what have you. I call it the role player's guess who.
Yeah, I could see that. You do. You have all the answers right in front of you, like guess who. I that's actually not a bad bad name for it. I dig it. So while Dubious wasn't what I expected, it ended up being somewhat something perfect for my family, really, honestly. Like, everyone has enjoyed this. My youngest daughter, Jen, has declared this her favorite board game of all time. It is one she keeps asking to play, and every time we're headed over to Brenda's on the weekend, it's, can we bring Dubious? And when we were like, is there anything you want us to bring to our local event at the Walkerville Brewery? She's like, you better bring Dubious. This is great. My mother-in-law also enjoyed it. Like, just a huge range of players. We've had some success with this one out at public play events, where we had a game where, like, the local indie RPG player loved it, along with someone who showed up to an event expecting to play Monopoly. There's a lot more universal appeal to this game than I would have expected.
We kind of mentioned this earlier, but I want to say it again, that the only thing with playing this with younger kids, or perhaps anyone that English isn't their first language or anything, is the game will be ruined by anyone not understanding what a certain role is. So you have to go through and go, okay, do you know what an inquisitor is? Do you know what, do you know what all these things mean? Because the Victorian age one, my youngest daughter didn't know all of those words, or didn't, she thought she knew some of them and didn't have the correct definitions for them. And it did put a kink in her first play of the game.
Totally fair. Now, the only fault I can find really with this game is that I don't know how often I'd want to play it. It does take a bit of the right group and mood, so it's not going to be a game you play every week for a lot of people, I suspect. That being said, I think it really does deserve a place in collection, even if it isn't going to be coming out every single week.
Now, I said I don't really like social deduction games, but I have a feeling, and I don't know this because I don't like them, but I think players who do like social deduction games would love this. Like, I have a feeling if you like that werewolf, if you like the secret whatever, if you're into those kind of games, if you like One Night Ultimate Werewolf or Werewords, I think you'd get something out of Dubious I didn't. And I really think that group of players would dig this game.
If you are a big fan of One Night or any of the group social deduction games and do like Dubious, do let us know. Drop into our comments or into our Discord and give us your thoughts on this game, because as people who don't play that sort of game, we'd love your opinions.
Yeah, I'm super curious about that.
Now, I also recommend this for people who like tabletop RPGs or RPG elements in games. Now, when I say RPG elements, I'm not talking about hit points and levels and armor class. There's none of that here. This is not that kind of game. Even when you play the fantasy setting, you're not going to worry about your inventory. Instead, you're going to be coming up with a character, then answering questions as that character, which in essence is playing a role. This is also going to appeal to drama and improv fans for these reasons.
This is a great game to pull out if your RPG night fell apart at the last minute and with a key player not able to be there.
Yeah, Gwen brought this to her board game club at the high school, and she said it was really popular with the kids that are in the drama program. I'm like, yep, that makes sense.
Yeah, that tracks. As for everyone else, you do or don't like social deduction, you've never played an RPG before, you're not into drama, give it a shot. Just don't expect it to be a party game. That is not what this is. This is, it seems to be put into the party game social deduction category. Everyone tends to think of those as, laugh out loud, quick games. This one does take some time because you have to sit there and come up with characters. You've got to come up with answers. And there is a lot of note taking in this. You are writing down all of your answers. That's part of the game. This isn't a quick filler, but it's also short enough that you can play multiple rounds in a single night.
This has that party game feel to me where I really don't care about the scoring as much as I should. Maybe I know being able to trick people and getting those points is part of the fun of the game, but it's more just about the experience of sitting down and playing the game. So, sit down, take your time, enjoy it. Yeah, I don't think it's going to fit that 30-minute box time. It's going to be more like an hour, but it's an enjoyable hour.
Now, as for me, I recently learned there's a follow-up to Dubious coming. Dubious New Realms. It's going to have three new settings, more occupations, and more secrets, and I am really looking forward to playing a sci-fi themed game of Dubious. Now, the other two themes in this box will include Antiquity, which I know will appeal to Deanna, and for the rest of the world who absolutely adores it, there will be a Cthulhu Methos version.
2 out of 3 ain't bad. I want it.
So what I want to know is, where's Super Dubious? Villains, heroes, henchmen, sidekicks, pesky reporters. There are so many options right there.
So Dubious, even more new realms. if you're listening, Hobby World, we would love to see a super version.
I want more questions. That's what I want them to add in. And I know there'll probably be more questions that are for those themes, but I would like more questions to add into each theme because I felt like there was not quite enough variability there.
Actually, it'll be interesting to see because Dubious New Realms is a standalone game and should have the generic questions that you use every game. I wonder if they'll be different than the one in this set. And if they are, then you can match the two together.
That would be great. So that's it for our look at Dubious from Hobby World, localized to North America by Arcane Wonders. It's a fascinating mashup of board game and RPG that hits all the right spots for us.
We love seeing the RPG and board game worlds collide. What's your favorite board game that includes role-playing elements? Or other ways around, what's a TTRPG that features some cool stuff from the world of board gaming?
Let us know in the comments. Send me an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com or hit me up on social media where I can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Support the Tabletop Bellhop by joining our Patreon. You can find it at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. There you'll find some public posts like announcements and upcoming show topics, but the good stuff, like the first thought reviews and bonus audio, are saved for patrons only.
Welcome to our review of Pirate Tails, a simple-to-learn but engaging game where pirate squirrels compete to collect the best hoard of nuts. Now, I'm going to try and keep the nut puns to a minimum, but it's hard.
Pirate Tails comes from Skybound Tabletop, who we have to thank for sending us a review copy. Was designed by Whitney Lorraine and features artwork from Sonia Henna. Published last year and should be available at your friendly local game store as well as most online stores.
This memory-based game plays 2 to 5 players with games going nice and quick, under 30 minutes, even at higher player counts. That's just for one round, though. We found that most groups like to play this a couple times in a row.
Now, Board Game Geek lists this as a weight of 1, but only one person has voted at this point, so it's likely going to shift up slightly. While the basic mechanics in Pirate Tails are pretty simple, there's thinking, memory, and card counting required to play well. Now, a suggested age of 8+ does fit for these reasons.
So in Pirate Tails, you're a scurvy squirrel looking to amass a hoard of nuts. Each turn, you'll draw 3 nut cards from the deck, 1 you keep, 1 you'll reveal at an island, and the last you will bury at a different island. Now, instead of drawing new cards, you can instead raid the nuts on one island. Round ends when all the nuts on the islands are claimed. Points are awarded for nut sets at the end of 3 rounds.
The component quality here is what you would expect from a mass market card game. The entire game is cards. Just cards. There's no tokens or anything like that. The box has a cardboard insert that you will have to remove if you want to play with sleeved cards. And personally, I found the artwork a bit kiddie looking.
I didn't mind the art at all. It reminded me a little bit of Point Salad. Also, squirrels won't get scurvy because nuts actually have quite a bit of vitamin C. Now, with that, let's move on to an overview of play.
So place a set of hiding spaces out on the table equal to the number of players. Each player select 2 suits of nuts and 2 candy cards. Shuffle those all together and you're ready. That's it.
Each turn, players have 2 options. The most common action being to search for nuts. You draw 3 cards in turn, 1 at a time, and with each card, you decide what you want to do with it. You keep it, placing it face down in front of you. You reveal it by placing it face up at a hiding place, or you bury it face down at a hiding place. Each option can only be taken once, and the card you reveal can't be at the same spot as the one you bury.
The other option is to raid the hiding spot by taking all of the nuts from one hiding spot. Note some of these will be face up and some will be face down. Each hiding spot can only hold 5 cards, and if all the hiding spots are full, you must take the raid action. Cards collected can be looked at, but must remain in the same state they were taken. Face up cards stay face up, and face down cards stay face down.
The round ends when all hiding spots have been raided. A new round begins with players who raided last getting the first play. Players keep all the cards they've collected between rounds. Game continues for 3 rounds, reshuffling the draw deck as needed.
At the end of the 3rd round, everyone calculates their score. Each set of nuts of the same type are worth points based on how many you collected. With 0 points for 1 nut, your lowest value nut if you collected 2, your middle value nut if you collected 3, and your highest value nut if you collected four or more.
Mixed in the nuts are also candy cards. Squirrels love candy even more than nuts, but too much of it makes them sick. You get 5 points for each of the first two candy cards you collect, but if you collect three or more, you ate too much candy and get no points for those cards.
And that's it. That Pirate Tails is that simple. Every round, draw three cards, decide what to do with them. What's that simple statement doesn't get across, though, is how much strategy and memory is required to actually do this well.
It's simple, but I had a hard time getting a handle on the scoring at first. I had Mo show me the chart about 16 times, and I want to print out little reference cards to give to people when we play this game.
Yeah, it's really hard to get the scoring right on the first try. It's not hard, it's just not obvious. I highly recommend taking extra time to explain the scoring again and maybe again during any teach.
Yeah, because you get nothing for one nut, your lowest for two, your middle for three, max at four. This means if you've got a 12, the highest card in a suit, but it's paired with a zero, you get nothing. If you also have a three, now you get three because that's the card in the middle. The only way you'll ever score that 12 is have four or more matching nuts in that suit. Now, this system also means there's really no reason to collect more than four in a suit unless you know you're getting a higher card than you already have, or maybe to deny another player from getting a set. And what I would recommend and what I'm going to do going forward is probably play a single round of the game, score that, and then restart, making sure everyone's on the same page.
Yeah, because if I remember correctly, there was someone that was really happy they had six or seven of the same nut, and that's not a great scoring position for you.
Yeah, that was me. I went at my first time at the barbershop bar. I had like all of the eights. I was so proud of all of the peanuts. I was like so proud of this collecting job I did, and only to realize that it was kind of a waste and I got crushed because I didn't have anything else.
Now, another thing that adds depth is the card distribution, which we didn't cover in the rule teach, but there are only 1 0. Then two each of 1, 2, 3, and 5, then a single 8 and a single 12 in each suit. And then there's the candy, right? There's two pieces of candy per deck per player. Well, I'm not saying it's a card counter's dream or anything. It's still pretty light, but you do have to pay attention to what's going on. Like if you've got a 5, there's only an 8 and a 12 out there somewhere. And if you know someone else has that 12, you know the only better card's an 8, so you can make decisions based on if you should go fishing for it or not. Same thing with the candy, right? You only want two pieces, the perfect things to have two. But of course, part of the game might be to, you know, bury some candy where you think another player is going to take it next turn so that you make their squirrel sick and they get no points for the candy, right? Like there's a lot more going on than you would expect from a simple game about pirate squirrels and nuts.
You want to keep track, but you're just making a lot of educated guesses because a lot of things are face down. You want to remember what you've played face down and then don't go and pick up something that you forgot you put there. Or maybe you do want to go and get something you put there. It's a fair amount to keep track of and keep you engaged in the game. But I don't think really card counting is possible with that much blind information.
Yeah, personally, I think some of its weight depends on the player count. At the full player count, you are wasting your time trying to pay too much attention. With four other players revealing one card and hiding two, it's more or less a coin flip of what's in those face down cards.
First, I think Pirate Tails is at that great weight for a get to know you game, right? Something to kick off a game night or something to fill the gap between games. I also think it's great for public play as it looks super approachable and actually is, except for that slightly obscure scoring system.
I actually think the key to this one is to get people to not take it too seriously. If you're trying to play extremely strategic and try and figure out what every card is, and you're, you know, like I said, it's educated guesses. If you can do that and not get AP, like some of our children do, then it's a quick, enjoyable game.
I really like this game because I can play it without paying too much attention. Just throw your nuts on the table, chat with friends, keep an eye on what else is going on, maybe plan for what your next game is going to be after you're done playing.
So overall, Skybound is really impressing me with these light card games. We first reviewed Kiss the Goblin a few weeks back, which ended up being way more fun than we expected. And I got to say, Pirate Tails is the same. It's much more involved and engaging than I expected. I expected a kid's game, right? I'm thinking Uno with nuts or something like that. And it ends up, there's more to it, but it's still welcoming. It's still a great welcome mat game. It's still very friendly, family friendly, and I think even younger kids could enjoy it.
Yeah, it's a very family friendly game, but it is not a kid's game or a kiddie game, which, like I said, when I first saw the art, I kind of thought, oh, that's a kid's game. I'm not sure about that. I was a little dubious, but yeah, it's a good game.
Yeah, I could definitely see, you know, at our Walkerville event, that younger family thinking that it's for them, mm-hmm. when their kids are too young for this game, 100%. Mm-hmm. Even their older child who does play more of the games is not ready for this game yet.
Yeah, we said it right at the start, right? 8+ seems about right, right? Mm-hmm. Like younger players, not little kids. If you're looking for a light, accessible card game, good for a gathering of gamers or a family game night or a pirate themed game night, Pirate Tails is probably a good choice. It's a welcoming game that isn't quite as simple as it looks.
You know, if you've got people trickling in at the start of a game night, pull this one out and you won't be disappointed because of that quick play.
Now, I'm going to call it one comparison for the experienced gamers, the alpha gamers out there, right? This game actually has some similarities to Biblios and its follow-up for The King and Me. And I want to call this game Biblios Light. Those are games that tend to attract more seasoned gamers. And if you do generally prefer heavier card games, don't overlook Pirate Tails. Like, we keep telling you, don't take it too seriously, but you can. You can try to keep all that card count and keep track and look at what players have faced up and base. Oh, they're burying something there. So I have a feeling based on that, there's no way they're giving away a cashew because they've already got three. You can play the game that way. So don't regard it as a kid's game. There is quite a bit of strategy possible here.
That brings us to the end of our Pirate Tails review. Now I think it's time for a snack of mixed unsalted nuts. While we're munching down on those, why don't you let us know what your favorite pirate-themed board game is? We'll check the comments when we get back from our snack.
Comment here, or better yet, head over to the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com and let us know what kind of nuts you like there. Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Brian Van Beek, thank you, Brian.
William Fisher, thank you.
Andrew Dacey, thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen Thomas, thank you for being here all the time.
Sean P. Kelly, thanks, Sean.
And Derek Hissel, thanks, Derek.
Oh. That was the wrong color. It said D. We're all good.
Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but we're all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice is the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Just a reminder before we head out that we do have a Patreon, which you can find at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. There you can get a heads up on our live show topics, read first thoughts reviews, and listen to outtakes and bonus audio from each podcast episode.
That's it for tonight, folks. You can also support us by giving us a thumbs up, a like, leave a comment, or better yet, tell your friends and fellow gamers about our show.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Q. And
game on.